to basically ask a question exactly where you left off. You talked about the four radicals of freedom. Do you see any examples of the individuals that you say we need? Do you see any examples of these kind of people emerging? And who might they be?
I'm not saying that. Oh, sorry, do I ask this question?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have some examples, which doesn't mean that I agree with them on everything philosophically. But see, for example, the issue of Jordan Peterson. Jordan Peterson's book is on the top 10th of Amazon, not of philosophy books, of books in general. It's like 50 Shades of Grey, 12 Rules for Life, or Harry Potter, 12 Rules of Life. Why did Jordan Peterson become so prevalent? It's not because of his philosophy, it's because he stood up for freedom of speech. So what I see is that there are so many people out there who really have this urge to listen to something different, to something alternative from all these kind of bromides and all these platitudes. And the moment someone stands up, these people gain a lot of following. So I'm quite optimist on this term. Now, there is no problem with some conservatives like Peterson or Shapiro, because I said that you need a philosophically integrated view. And my problem with them is because maybe of their religiosity, they're very much into this idea of self-sacrifice, that individuals are not like these sacred entities. They have to sometimes step aside in favor of the group. But this is also the worldview, in a way, of every tribalist or every collectivist. So for example, they would say, who cares about your right of freedom of speech if you hurt these other people? So basically, shut up, because these people are hurt. Okay, so you also need to have this, to put forward this superiority of individual rights if you want to defend freedom of speech systematically. So I think these people are doing a great work, but philosophically, I'm not really on board with them, because I think there are some issues in their philosophy, and specifically this issue related to this idea of self-sacrifice to the group, which could potentially undermine the measure. But there's no objection to the fact that they are doing a great work. And I would say also that it's really sad that most of these people come from the right, because freedom of speech used to be a call for arms in the left. Okay? I don't know if they're honest about that. But for example, Rosa Luxemburg has written one of the best defenders of freedom of speech in the early 20th century. So the fact that now freedom of speech is only supported by conservatives is something that I find weird. Or maybe it shows the true face of the people who are today, or the worldview of the left. I don't know.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Yes.
Bill Tricker, Vanderbilt College. There's a question about, you talked a lot about the left during this talk. What is the left, really? Because when you look at today's leftish politics, you go from Venezuela's Maduro to Bernie Sanders, Corbyn, and to even if you stretch it, Emmanuel Macron in France. So what's the common trend between all those leaders, all those ideologies?
That's a very good point. Quite often I try to stop myself from doing this kind of generalization. So usually when I talk about the left, I mean people who refer to themselves as the left. And Latin America left is a very good example. Because the Latin America left, and this started with Cuba, they made the virtue, basically, out of their failure. So what did Cuba say at some point in the 1980s? Forget industrialization, we're going to have this brilliant organic agriculture. So we might be poor, but who wants this kind of environment ruining economic development anyway? So it's highly unlikely to find a leftist, with some notable exceptions, who are consistent in terms of being loyal to this modernity and this enlightenment project. Saying, for example, no, sky is the limit, we trust people. Why do you think, for example, the left is leading the non-state policies? Because their view is that we cannot trust these people. Okay, we middle class people, we can understand, for example, that eating junk food is wrong, but who can trust these like stupid working class people? Again, this is the opposite of what used to be the case with the left. The idea of the old left was that, at least in principle, or at least that's what they said, that we trust people. People can take life in their own hands. Nowadays, they're telling us the opposite. They're telling us, no, people are basically basket cases. And that's what we were saying earlier. Who basically introduced nanny state in this country? It was New Labour and their lifestyle policies. We need to have a state guardian to every family, SNP in Scotland, because we don't trust parents with their kids. We need to have sugar tax because we don't trust you with your eating habits. We need to ban smoking in pubs because pubs are not really private places, God forbid. It's an issue of public health, and we cannot trust you to negotiate this issue with a pub owner. So on the one hand, quite often I try to make sure that I don't create this generalized straw man, but actually, if you check every aspect of leftism, in 9 out of 10 of them, you will see that these tendencies are quite prevalent. In my ideal society, these people would be taken care of by the civil society, because I believe in civil society. I believe that we would not let our friend or our relative or our neighbor to suffer. Now, if, of course, obviously, if we got back the welfare state, we wouldn't start from these people. But my problem is not, I don't mean these people, because they actually do have problems which are very real. My problem is that more and more and more and more, today we put more groups of people in this category. So the idea is that more and more people are unable to cope. So it's not only people who have been unlucky or who had some misfortune in life. And the worst thing is that the mere fact of your biology, for example, of being a woman, now puts you in this, quote, minority group, which doesn't even make sense in terms of mathematics as a minority group. But again, why is this happening? It's happening because this idea that says we haven't got free will, or you have all these environmental kind of influences. Like, I had a chat the other day with a friend and said, ah, come on, how can you trust people? There are all these advertisements out there. People are brainwashed. And then you ask them, wait a minute, are you brainwashed? He said, no, of course not, but it's these other people. So it's always this urge. I think this is an urge to control. It's an urge that says, I know best what is good for you, therefore, I want to believe that you don't know what is good for you. And be careful, I'm not saying that these people gather in a dark room with cigars, kind of creating a master plan. They really believe these things. How do I know? I was one of them. I truly believe, and I was very passionate for helping people, and I truly believe that I know what is good for you, and you don't. So my idea was, for example, if you don't vote for the left, there's something wrong with you. You cannot understand what is good for you, but thank God, me and my friends, my middle class friends, are here and are going to help you. So, yes, two completely different things. On the one hand, there are people who are facing some real challenges because of bad luck, bad health. That's another huge discussion. We cannot have this discussion now, like where should state intervention start and stop with that. But we can agree that the tendency is that more and more and more categories of people are falling in this group of the quote, the vulnerable.
Yes.
Jude and Alan, I'm actually an alumni from the geography department, and incidentally, I was here and at York at the same time. I'm very rusty on Rousseau, but isn't this an old idea that Jean-Jacques Rousseau is forcing people to be free and somehow the state knew better what was required, so actually, and it would make them do what, if they really thought about it, they wouldn't be obese, they wouldn't go to pubs for too long. But isn't this really an old concept?
That's a great point, because it's not only Rousseau. It's funny that we consider Rousseau and Kant the main Enlightenment figures. In a way, Rousseau and Kant are the figures who, in a way, put an end to the Enlightenment philosophy. Because what does Rousseau say? he says that this kind of, it's basically the things that you mentioned. But also, Immanuel Kant, what is he saying? He's saying that reason can lead you up to a point. Reality cannot be accessed by, you cannot access reality by reason. Therefore, in a way, Kant opens the window for other things, things like faith, or Kant said, was it Kant who said, 10 million Frenchmen cannot be wrong, or something like that. So individual mind is fallible, but the collective mind is not, which again, epistemologically, it makes no sense. So you're very right, these are very old ideas, and that's the problem with the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment project was never complete in a way. And the Enlightenment project, it was undermined, one could say, from within. Now the difficult question is, if Kant and Rousseau are not part of the Enlightenment as it should be, then who is the Enlightenment philosopher par excellence? So that's a big discussion. But I agree that the new left doesn't appear out of the blue. For example, in the 19th century, we have the so-called romantic anti-capitalists, or we have the romantics also on the right, would say that industrial society is alienating, and if we could only go back to a more kind of coherent, organic society. But the problem is that in the 1960s, it's the first time that these trends are gaining mainstream. I mean, remember, even before that, remember things like Rebel Without a Cause. You have a protagonist who basically says, I'm alienated. I don't know exactly why, but I'm gonna lash out. I'm gonna have this emotional outburst. Sometimes when I see in Berkeley people shouting at speakers and like lashing out, what comes to my mind is these figures, which again, they don't come from the radical left. They come from the 1950s Hollywood.
Ben Baker from Van Milder. Would sort of just in general about the rise of extremism on both sides of the political spectrum, would you almost consider it inevitable given the freedom of spread of information? Where sort of we're not in a time anymore when individuals might hold views, but they'd never really get outside of their community, and now sort of they can and they congregate together on the internet and grow in number.
So in a way, I would give a contradictory answer. On the one hand, yes, these are predictable, but not because of that. I think these trends are predictable because they basically follow some platitudes that we all consider and we all tell all the time. For example, we say, okay, freedom of speech is a right, but it's not. Let's not get into extremes. This thing, let's not get into extremes, it gets in my nerves, because we say it all the time. Or we say, okay, there is, each side has its merit. Okay, let's not be extremes here. Whenever someone says that, I say, okay, should we say then that Hitler was not that bad? If at the end of the day, let's not be extreme. So if the one side says, for example, exterminate the Jews, and the other side says, oh my God, are you crazy? Is the truth somewhere in between? Of course not. So sometimes being an extremist is not something wrong. But we kept having these, again, these platitudes that says, well, you know, we have, we are things like we are the cancer of planet Earth, and progress has gone too far. And these were very fashionable ideas. You could see them in Hollywood, you could see them in university theaters, and no one, and or very few people dare to directly challenge them. I think what we see today is the logical conclusion of these ideas, of what I would call relativism. Relativism means, yeah, okay, you're right, but also the other side might be a bit right, which I think is not good. But what you said about the internet, could we say that in a way it's also the opposite? Like, who would know, for example, Jordan Peterson if it weren't for the internet, or things like the Dave Rubin show? So I think the internet is providing a service in terms of giving us alternatives, but also, like, if you have decided that I'm not going to think, it's much easier to find a bunch of ridiculous ideas online. Like, Google things like, I don't know, 9/11 was an inside job by the Israelis. 5 million results. So, you know, if your mind is set there, it's like, you see, it's not only me, there are all these. So the internet at the end of the day is what we make of it. But in general, I would say the overall result is positive, and I'm a bit optimistic on that. Because I believe people have the ability to think. So at the end of the day, if you come across what I consider the right ideas, then there is a chance.
Roger Charlotte Davis from Catholic Society. What I was quite interested in, this is a bit of a brief question, I'll admit. How do you reconcile sort of your ideas around free speech with the ideas of someone like, for example, Karl Popper as a contemporary who sort of makes the point on the limit of tolerance, just in terms of, obviously, I do agree to an extent that yes, it's absolutely vital to have free speech to encourage human flourishing, but what do we do about people who do want to restrict freedom of speech and won't listen?
Let me get this right. So are you asking me how do we oppose people who want to...
In the sense, so Popper's main sort of idea, which Rawl sort of picks up on, I suppose, is that essentially there is a limit at which tolerance,
in terms
of freedom of speech, obviously, is allowable insofar as, I think the citation he gives is Weimar Germany, where obviously extremist factions on the left and right were very much allowed to repress freedom of speech, but the centre being pro-free speech, as per the Weimar Constitution, didn't feel capable of responding. How do we respond to those fringe elements while also protecting freedom of speech as a wider principle? Can we reconcile that?
That's a very difficult hypothetical question, because I think historically Popper is not right. Because think about the Nazi Party. There was a big period when the Nazi Party was outlawed. All the publications were not out in the public, and this was the time when the Nazi Party grew. Or in my country, in Greece, do you know the Golden Dawn, the Nazi? And when I say Golden Dawn are fascist, I don't mean like, here people are fascists. I mean like proper fascist, proper like skinheads, Aryan salute kind of people. There was a complete ban in terms of media appearance of the Golden Dawn for quite a period of time. And unfortunately, this was the time when they grew on the underground. So the best thing you can do with these ideas is face them out in the open. Practically, because ideas can only be defeated with ideas, but also it's because their ideas are so ridiculous that I think the only way they succeed is because quite rarely they have someone asking them a difficult question. And forget Golden Dawn. I will return to the alt-right, the white nationalists in the United States. The typical interview with Richard Spencer is a TV pundit asking him, so, are you a supporter of Hitler? Do you think the Third Reich was a good idea? Like stupid questions. When somebody asks him, okay, let me ask you a question. You claim that you are, let's say, you are the real voice of the conservative movement. So what about the black conservative, like Thomas Sowell, for example? Or what about the white Jew? Why is he not part of your ethnostate? So the moment you ask them a mildly clever question, they're completely blocked because they haven't got answers. So I think putting their opinions under the rug and basically hiding them, one, it gives them this aura of we are the martyrs, but also it stops them from engaging them. And I don't think the reason that the Nazi Party came to power was the fact that German was a utopia of freedom of speech and of liberalism. Actually, again, if you see a lot of the legislation of the Weimar Republic, because it was against the Nazis and the Communist Party, they tried as much as possible to curtail the right to free speech. So I don't agree with Popper, although I understand that it's a difficult question. But again, free speech can only be absolute within the context of individual rights. For example, you don't have freedom of speech in my house. Okay, I haven't got freedom of speech in the newspaper of the Communist Party. I cannot send them an article that supports, I don't know, Ayn Rand, and tell them, by not publishing this article, you curtail my freedom of speech. And this is very important because some people today are trying to fight for freedom of speech by undermining it. For example, Milo Yiannopoulos was banned from Twitter. Government needs to intervene on Twitter. It's like, wait a minute. The official definition of censorship is government regulating speech. So maybe what Twitter does is horrible, not with Milo, I don't care, with Jenna, whoever. But it is within their rights. We can criticize them. We can say you're creating a public sphere which is boring, or which is missing something, but we cannot call the government to intervene and force Twitter to have Milo back. Because then it means we don't understand what is the context in which freedom of speech is absolute. Freedom of speech is absolute within your individual rights. I haven't got the right to pay a hitman and say, kill that guy, and then say, but I didn't press the gun, I just it was just words. Okay? So it is absolute within the context of your of individual rights. I haven't got the right to pay someone to kill you, therefore my words were not merely speech.
Someone has a sort of mental perception that every problem is a kind of collective problem, then there's no sort of onus on the individual to have some kind of at least epistemological sort of responsibility to get the sort of facts right before they go out doing something. So,
what should the individual do?
Well, it's more that like when people sort of engage with public debate, they talk a lot in sort of like general terms. I think that this is a big reason why people don't like free speech so much, and they're not so keen on like individual rights in the same way that, say,
so basically they view the world in terms of collectives.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I call tribalism. And I think, again, it's in the roots of the problem. Because if the most important thing is a tribe, and this could be the nation, the class, the race, whatever, then again, who cares about your individual rights, including your right to free speech? But in terms of putting the question on, again, what should you do as an individual, I would say it's quite liberating when you decide that I don't care what people are going to think, I'm going to put my opinion out there. I was saying to all that during the Brexit referendum, I was afraid to speak because I didn't want to disappoint my colleagues, but most importantly, I wasn't 100% sure. But once I started saying my opinion, and for me it was extra difficult because I spent basically the first 28 years of my life in the left. And I mean hardcore left, because Greece, when you talk about left, again, it's not like the Labour Party. So it was difficult. I lost friends, but there's something quite liberating when you say, look, this is my opinion. I've spent days and nights thinking about that stuff. And I'm gonna say it. And it's the only way you can build a character. Because you build a character when it matters, you're present. When it matters, you put yourself there and you make it count with your opinion.
Yes. Thomas Banbury, Van Mulder College. I was going to ask what you foresee as the future of identity politics in political discourse. Is it something that's going to sort of wither under the likes of intellectual scrutiny, or is it going to become more insidious? Or is it something we just have to sort of ride out until it eventually comes to its conclusion?
I think this is the million-dollar question. Because I keep changing my mind on that. So the quick question is, I haven't got an answer. What I'm saying is basically a rant. So that I see two occasions. One is this kind of dystopia that this becomes a mantra that cannot anymore be challenged. And it was quite interesting. Some months ago, there was this midterm election somewhere in the United States, and all the discussion was, white people are gonna vote this way, black people are gonna vote this way. And that's. But at the same time, you see so many people now challenging these attitudes. And I think it will start also expanding, for example, in the business world, because if for example, YouTube tomorrow says Dave Rubin, what's the other guy, Joe Rogan, Jordan Peterson, all these people are out. There's going to be this gap, let's say, in the market, for people who are interested in this kind of idea. So if you jump in and you, let's say, create another formula which is welcome for them. For example, first time I heard about Patreon was with all these people when their videos were demonetized on YouTube. So suddenly they say, okay, support us in Patreon. And now suddenly everyone knows Patreon and everyone is using Patreon. So, okay, that's going to be a horrible answer, but it's either going to get worse or it's either going to get better. But I don't know, like, what's your take on that? What do you think? Are you an optimist on that?
I'd like to be optimistic, certainly. These sort of peripheral trends, I think, would die down eventually as people come to be a bit more optimistic about getting along with each other. But
yeah,
that's quite a naive view.
But also the other side, they like, again, I would turn back to this Cathy Newman interview. That was so, so bad. It was, in my opinion, if we take the mainstream media, there's a good case that it was the worst interview in living memory. I mean, I've never seen something like that. And I think a lot of people were, quote, okay, I don't say want to say red pill, because apparently it's right-wing weirdos in the state who use this legal, but anyway, this was a moment where a lot of people said, wait a minute, something weird is happening here. What is that? Like, this guy is probably not a master. And again, if you see his book sales after that, or even with less serious personalities, like, I would never know about Milo Yiannopoulos if it weren't the people showing up in his speech. Of course, my life did not become better by finding out about Milo. But anyway, I'm just mentioning it, okay? So I think these people, in a way, are shooting their own foot with this kind of religious zeal that they are showing. It sounded very creepy on that.
Any further questions? Anyone at all? No. Well, in that case, thank you very much, Dr. Stilicopoulos. It's been an absolute pleasure. One final round of applause.